It's my honor to have a chance to give this talk. And my topic is Schatten properties for non-commutative Martingale paraproduct. And this is joint work with Zhang Hao. And I will follow this sequence to give this talk. First, I will introduce the Hankel operator. That is the reason why we need to study the paraproduct. And then I will introduce the paraproduct on two RD commutative Martingale and the paraproduct on DRT semi-commutative Martingale. And then for two applications, I will give the non-commutative Martingale paraproducts. The first one is the CR case, and the second one is the tensor product of the matrix MD case. Finally, I will give a brief sketch of the proof. So why we need to study the paraproduct? Because paraproduct is a Hankel type operator. So first, I need to give the definition of the Hankel operator. A Hankel operator can be defined as an operator whose matrix has a form alpha j plus k, where jk is not less than zero. For example, for a finite Hankel matrix, it has this form. From the matrix, we can see that it's a symmetric matrix, and the element only depends on the first coordinate and the second coordinate. And now, what are the good properties of the Hankel operator? In 1957, Nihalri gives the boundedness of the Hankel operator. He said that Hankel operator is bounded if and only if there is a bounded function phi on the unit circle T, such as the hat phi g equal to alpha g, where the hat phi g is a sequence of Fourier coefficients of phi. Moreover, he gives a norm of the Hankel operator. And the next year, in 1958, Hartmann describes the compactness of the Hankel operator. It's if and only if alpha j equal to the hat phi j for some continuous function phi on t. These two theorems give the boundedness and the compactness properties of the Hankel operator. Here we give some remarks. First one is that the boundedness and the compactness property of the Hankel operator can be described in terms of the BMO space and the VMO space. And the Schatten property of Hankel operator can be described in terms of the Bessel space, in terms of the BMO space, VMO space, and the Bessel space. The definition of this we will introduce later. And the Martingale paraproducts, we will find that they are Hankel type operators. So for Martingale paraproducts, we can study the compactness, the boundedness, and the Schatten properties of them. The last remark is that the Hankel operators had many applications in mathematics and applied mathematics. For example, the prediction theory, control theory, and the system theory. So now we introduce the paraproduct on two RD commutative Martingale. I will first introduce what is the dyadic inverse and what is the commutative martingale on it, and finally, I will define the paraproduct on it. What is a two-dyadic inverse? Let D denote the collection of all dyadic inverses on the real line R. It has this form. From the form, we can see that it has good advantages because it has, for any I, J in D, it has only four cases. I equals to J. I in G, and then G in I, and the intersection of I and G are empty. But for example, this is I, this is G. This case doesn't exist. So we can, for the future proof, we can only consider these four cases. So then we let Dn denote the collection of intervals in D of length 2 minus n. And we let tilde I denote the parent inverse of I. I positive and I negative denote the left and right halves of I. And then we let Di is a collection of dyadic inverse contained in D. The Di prime is a collection of dyadic inverse contained properly in D, in I. And Di is the intersection of Dn and Di. So these are the construction of the dyadic inverse. Using this, we can construct the hard basis on L2R. That is, we define the Hi is a hard function corresponding to I. It has this form using the characteristic function. And we can check that the hard this form forms the orthogonal basis of the Hilbert space L2R. And we can also define the martingale on the on it. So let F be the sigma field generated by all inverse in D, and Fn be the n field generated by all inverse in Dn. Dx is a Lebesgue measure of omega. Then we can define omega is the two-dyadic probability space. So martingale on omega is called two-dyadic martingale. Now we can define for F in L1 omega, we can define Fn is a conditional expectation of F with respect to Fn, and define the martingale difference Df and D0f equal to F0. So F can be written as martingale differences. Now we have the dyadic inverse and the martingale. So we now define the paraproduct on two-dyadic commutative martingale. That is, for given B in L2R, we define pi BF is the sum of DnB multiplied Fn minus 1, where n belongs to Z. For any f in L2R. This equation is too formal, so we can use the dyadic inverse to write pi bf in a more concrete form. So first, we let MRF is the mean value of I. It's the inner product of the character function and F. And FI is the Hard coefficient. It's the inner product of HI, F, and F. So for F in L2R, we can use the Hard basis to represent the F. And for FK, we can use two methods to represent. The first method is we can use the characteristic function to write FK. And second, we can use the Hard basis to write FK. So FK has two forms. And we can calculate DKF. Finally, we get the pi BF in the sum of the MRF multiply BI multiply HI. It's a more concrete form because we can calculate it more convenient. Surely the pi b star f can be calculated. As I said before, the Hankel operator can the properties of Hankel operator can be described using the BMO, VMO, and the Bessel space. Now we have defined the paraproduct, so we next define these three spaces. First, we need to define the dyadic BMO space. We first define the PRF is the orthogonal projection on span HJ via J in DI. Then we define the norm of BMO D. We say it's a BMO space if the norm is finite. And we also can also define the dyadic VMO space if B satisfies these three equations. And we can also define the dyadic Bessel space BPD if the BPD norm of B if is finite. So these are three definitions of space. Finally, in 1996, Chao and Peng gives a description of the boundedness, Schatten properties, and compactness of the paraproduct on the commutative Martingale. That is, B in BMO if and only if pi B is in BL2R. B in PPD if and only if pi B is in SPLPR. B in VMO if and only if pi B in KL2R. So the boundedness of the paraproduct can be described using the BMO space. The Schatten properties of the paraproduct can be described using the Bessel space, and the compactness of the paraproduct can be described using the VMO space. And this is the two-ordered commutative Martingale case. The next we will only study the Schatten properties of the paraproduct. So next, we will introduce the paraproduct on d-adic semi-commutative Martingale. Compare these two paraproducts. The first difference is that the previous case is two-adic, but now we generalized it to the d-adic case. In two ideal cases, we divide the intervals into two sub-intervals. But in D ideal case, we divide every intervals into D sub-intervals. So we can also define the associated dyadic intervals. It only change two into D. And the other definitions still remain. Also, we can define the Martingale on the sigma field generated by the dyadic dyadic inverse. So we can define the RF omega is a dyadic probability space, and Martingale on R is called the dyadic Martingale. And we can also define the associated hard space of L to R in terms of the dyadic intervals. It has this form, where I in D, I in 1 to up to D minus 1. We can see that if D equal to 2, it's just the hard basis we defined before. And the second difference is that we generalized it to the semi-commutative Martingale. In the commutative Martingale, the domain is R and the value is R, is in R. But in semi-commutative Martingale, the domain is still in R. But the value is in L to M, where M is a von Neumann algebra. So we let M be the von Neumann algebra, and we regard X in M as a left multiplication operator on B L to M. So we can also define the semi-commutative Martingale. But in this case, the domain is R, but the value is in L to M. And we can also define the Martingale differences. So in dyadic semi-commutative Martingale, we can also define the associated paraproduct. It's for given B in L to R to L to M, pi BF has this form, is a semiform. So in this case, we can also write it in a more concrete form. Before calculating the pi BF, we give some notations. We can consider L to R to L to M as a Hilbert space tensor product L to R tensor L to M. And the concrete fact is that for F in L to R and X in L to L, we let the F tensor X is element and it x on the t in R is equal to ft multiply x. The value is in L to M. And we can also define the notation of the tensor of the inner product between the L to R and the L to R to L to M. Is that F, if Fg in L to R and X in L to M, we can define the inner product of F and G times X is equal to the inner product F and G multiply X. This test product value is in L to M. Writing this is because we can calculate more conveniently. So we can calculate pi bf. First, we can using the diadic Hall basis to write f, and we can also calculate fk using the characteristic function of all the Hall basis and the Martingale differences. Finally, we can calculate pi bf. It is equal to the sum of Hi tensor, the inner product of Hall basis and B, and multiply the characteristic function and F. And now we can also define the associated Bessel space if this norm is finite. In the two-adic commutative Martingale, this term is a scalar valued, but in this case we change it into the LP norm. LPM, the norm of LPM. So we finally we can describe the Schatten properties or paraproduct on diadic semi-commutative Martingale using the associated Bessel space. It's that B in L to R to L to M, then pi B is in LP B L to R tensor M if and only if B in BPD. This theorem describes the Schatten properties of the paraproduct on the generalized diadic semi-commutative Martingale. So then we give two applications in the non-commutative paraproduct case. The first one is the CIR case, namely the Clifford algebra case. First, we introduce the definition of the Clifford algebra. First, we give the polymetrics sigma 0, sigma 1, and sigma 2. And then we define the Cn is the this form where the sigma 1 and the sigma 2 occurred in the nth position. We can check that the Cn are self-adjoint unitary operators and satisfy the following canonical anti-commutation relations Cj Ck plus Ck Cj equal to 2 delta jk. Then we define the Clifford algebra is the phenomenal algebra generated by the Cn. It's a definition of the Clifford algebra. And we can also define the paraproduct on the L to C. So let C be the CR algebra, and F denotes the family of all finite subsets of N. So we can first define the orthogonal basis of L to C. So we arrange the integers of A in increasing order and write A, for example, k1 less than k2 less than kn. Then we let max I equal to kn. Then we define ci has this form. and we can verify that CA is an orthogonal basis of L to C. And the sigma CA, where max I is not more than N, is a filtration of C. So we can define the associated pair product of L to C. It has still this form, but it is on the non-commutative case because the domain and value is in L to C. And we can also define the associated basis space, BP, where the coefficient is 2 to k. The norm is finite. We say the basis space. And we can also describe the Schatten properties of the paraproduct on it. For B in L to C, pi B is in LP B L to C if and only if B in BP. This theorem describes the Schatten properties in terms of paraproduct in non-commutative case. And this is the Clifford case. The second application is the tensor product of the matrix MD case. Here, M is the tensor product of IK from where K from 0 to infinity, where IK is the D multiplied D matrix. And Mn is the filtration of M. And we can also define the pair product on L to M. Still has this form. And define the associated basis space. Where the coefficient is D to 2k. And we can also describe the Schatten properties of the pair product in this case using the basis space. Okay, finally, I give the brief proof of the main theorem in semi-commutative case. Pi B is in LP, B L to R tensor M if and only if B in BPD. Because the proof is very long, so I just give the main idea of the proof. The sufficiency of the theorem, we used the inductive method. First, we consider P is between 0 and 1. It's easy to compute calculate the norm of pi B. And when P is between 1 and 2, we just use the following equations. The advantage is that we can change the domain of P, the value of P between 0 and 1. And we can go to the first case to calculate. And for P between 2 and 4, we can also use the same method to reduce P between 1 and 2. In this case, we need the core idea is decomposing the pi b star pi b into pi s b plus pi s b star plus d b, where the right side has the following form. Although it looks too long, but the main idea is that this decomposition is we decompose the pi b star pi b into the upper triangle matrix, the lower triangle matrix, and the diagonal matrix. These two terms we have known facts, and the diagonal matrix we can easily calculate it. So this is the case where P between 2 and 4. And for example, P is between 4 and 8, P is between 8 and 16. We can also using the inductive method. So inductively, the sufficiency of the theorem is true. And the converse direction, the main idea is that we transfer pi b into the block diagonal form. In this progress, we get the converse direction. This is just the very, very brief idea of the proof. So we can finally prove this theorem is a description of the Schatten class of the paraproduct on semi-commutative case. So that's all. Thank you.